Jarrah rants through 9 minutes of Exhibit D, Part 1 and Part 2, building his case that the scientific community has been blind for 40 years to the existence of water in NASA's moon rocks. His parade of scientists, who say there is no water in NASA's moon rocks, include the infamous Red Zero, whose website no longer exists, the apparent moon rock expert and YouTuber, Mr. Craig 41, and Jarrah's favorite three antagonists, Phil Plate, Jay Windley, and Robert Brannig. Then he attempts to prove them all wrong using nothing less than a space.com article.
It is simply false to say that the lunar samples contain no water. On July 9th, 2008, space.com announced that water has been found conclusively for the first time inside ancient moon samples brought back by Apollo astronauts. The discovery may force scientists to rethink the lunar past and future.
The operative word in the space.com title is samples. Water was found in moon samples. This space.com article covers a report published in Nature magazine on July 10, 2008. Several other scientific news services also cover this report. Scientific America named their article, Lunar Lava Beads Show Moon Once Harbored Water. Chemical and Engineering News titled their article, Moon Glass Contains Water. Oddly, Jarrah found a cover on this story with possibly the most ambiguous title, one that did not include the words glass or beads. The space.com article doesn't make that particular distinction until the second paragraph. These volcanic beads, or spherules, were ejected from the lunar volcanoes as tiny droplets of molten glass that quickly cooled on the outside, forming a smooth eggshell-like container, trapping the water and other goodies on the inside to cool later, while keeping unwanted environmental contaminants out. Such spherules are found in the lunar regolith and range in diameter from 2 micrometers to several millimeters. Since they formed in the low lunar gravity, many of them are perfect spheres, unlike their counterparts on Earth. The first fallacy that Jarrah uses here is called cherry-picking, choosing a statement, or in this case an article title, that is most favorable to his claim.
Interestingly, it seems that the space.com article is nothing new. In February 2001, Dr. Mark Norman of the University of Tasmania had this to say when interviewed for Science at NASA. Lunar samples have almost no water in their crystal structure. There is a huge difference between almost no water and no water. When I first saw this article, it seemed odd to me that the scientific community could have missed the presence of water all these years. And with Dr. Norman's statement long predating this discovery, we have to conclude that NASA and the propagandists have known all these years about the water in the moon rocks, and they intentionally misled the public into believing otherwise.
This excerpt is a veritable tsunami of misinformation that contains at least 3 different logical fallacies. First, inferring that since these volcanic spherules contain water, then all moon rocks must contain water is called a fallacy of composition. The 276 spherules examined by Alberto Sol and his colleagues at Brown University make up only a few grams of the total haul that the Apollo astronauts brought back from the lunar surface. And because of their structure, they are the least permeable of all the samples to water that may have been introduced from terrestrial sources. Although this finding indicates that water may exist, or at one time existed, deep in the lunar interior, you cannot deduce from this article alone that all moon rocks contain measurable water. Second, the fact that the scientists had not previously found conclusive evidence of water in these tiny spherules wouldn't have seemed so odd to Jarrah if he had just read halfway through the space.com article, because it clearly explains, in plain English, that this discovery was made possible by recent improvements in detection methods. The article states that for the past 40 years, the limit for detecting water in any geological samples was 50 parts per million. Now, with the aid of secondary ion mass spectrometry, they can detect presence of water down to 5 parts per million. That means that nobody over the past 40 years has lied when they've said that there is no measurable water in moon rocks. And as of July 2008, when this Space.com article was published, the only measurable water that had been detected in lunar samples, not previously attributed to contamination, was in these tiny volcanic spherules. Ignoring facts that are staring him right in the face is a tactic that Jarrah uses quite often, the fallacy of omission. Third, Dr. Mark Norman's statement in the 2001 NASA article, The Great Moon Hoax, that lunar samples have almost no water trapped in their crystal structure, does not blow the whistle on any NASA cover-up. All you need to do is look back to when the moon rocks first arrived on Earth. From the very beginning, scientists had detected trace water in the moon rocks brought back by the Apollo astronauts. But since those rocks contain no mica, clay minerals, or hydrous iron oxides, minerals that would be present if water had actually played a part in their formation, it was assumed that the trace water was contamination that had leaked into the containers used to house the moon rocks during their long trip from the moon to Houston. Some scientists, like Dr. Norman, mention this trace water, while other scientists dismiss it because other indicators suggested it was not of lunar origin. Jarrah basically builds a straw man argument that NASA and the scientific community at large have been trying to hide the existence of water in moon rocks for 40 years, but occasionally someone like Dr. Norman slips and exposes the cover-up. This is absurd. Nobody is hiding anything. In fact, Friedman, Gleason, and Hardcastle presented one of the first reports discussing the presence of water in lunar materials at the Apollo 11 Lunar Science Conference in January 1970, and the report was subsequently published in February 1970. It's kind of hard to keep something a secret when you present a report on it at a conference in front of your peers in the press and later publish it. So much for Jarrah's first straw man of the series. If you're interested, you'll find a link to this fascinating report in the sidebar for this video.
But as we've just learned, there is water in those rocks. Meaning, there is no big difference between moon rocks and Earth materials.
Of course, using this logic, you could say that there's no big difference between spaghetti and lima beans. They both contain water, don't they? Obviously, that's a wrong assumption. Jarrah's hasty conclusion that moon rocks are identical to Earth materials simply because they both contain water, or any single characteristic for that matter, is a fallacy of equivalence. And Jarrah uses this tactic boldly throughout his entire Exhibit D series. The truth is that the lunar spherules contain only 40 to 70 parts per million of water, compared to about 750 parts per million or more in their terrestrial cousins. This is a big quantitative difference. Also, the trace water detected in the lunar basalts when they first arrived on Earth amounts to less than 0.01% by weight, compared to 0.2% to 1% by weight for their terrestrial cousins. Another big quantitative difference. So clearly, Earth rocks and moon rocks cannot be construed to be identical based on their water content alone. After Jarrah published his Exhibit D series, this Space.com article was updated to reflect the findings from the Cassini, Chandrayaan-1, and Deep Impact spacecraft, which have remotely detected the same signature of water, or at least hydroxyl, on the lunar surface that was originally detected in the Apollo moon rocks. Sadly, for Jarrah, this quantitative finding only serves to validate the Apollo moon rocks as having come from nowhere else but the equatorial region of the moon. So, what have we learned? Well, we've learned that you can't point at every scientist and geologist who over the past 40 years has said that moon rocks have no measurable water in them, call them all liars, and then provide a source as evidence that says they had no way to measure it. And suggesting that moon rocks are identical to Earth rocks simply because they both contain water in far different proportions is nothing short of obfuscation. Oh well. Better luck next time, Jarrah. Ciao, moon hoax conspirators, wherever you are.